I'm going to ask you this because you're an assistant principal. Mm-hmm. And I wrote this article years ago. It's actually one of my most popular articles. And it is about specifically about the assistant principal. So I list four things that I think are important to being an effective assistant principal. So I'm going to tell you what I said, but I want you to tell me, do you think it's relevant and how do you do it? If you do think it's relevant. Okay. All right. So the first attribute I say is that they are self-starters. Is that important? And how do you do that? I already know your answer to this one. I already know that you think it's important. I just don't know.
Yeah. Because you know my background. Yeah. So, yeah. Because like, here's the deal is if you are doing your job, you should be assessing the campus and the needs of everybody, right? So the community, the teachers, the students. So if you're truly assessing and you see that there's a need, which you will and should, then you better do something about it. You shouldn't be just, you know, sitting up in your office trying to ignore the problems that are occurring. So you're going to have an initiative that you are sitting, right? Like for the restorative practices, I didn't just sit back and say, well, this is just the system that we live in.
Right.
And be fine with that. No,
better, right?
You create something. Yeah, I got to do something. So I'm going to create a relationship action team. Of course, I got the support from my principal, but you know, I took that on. The principal didn't come. It was me that was leading it because I was passionate about it, and that was my solution to the problem. So yes, you need to be a starter.
Okay. So and the just kind of building on that, a lot of people say like, I don't want to be micromanaged, but then a lot of assistant principals are like, can you just tell me what to do and I'll do it? And it's like, well, I don't need you to be a mini version of me. And like, right. it's like the Dwight Schrute assistant to the regional manager versus assistant manager, right? Those are very different roles.
Very.
We're kind of thinking about that. So I will give a shout out to Cheryl Johnson. She was my first assistant principal. I know she doesn't listen. She's retired and I think she doesn't, I don't know, but if she is listening, Cheryl, you're amazing. So Cheryl Johnson worked with me when I was principal. She was assistant principal at the same time. And I never asked her to do one thing the entire time that I was principal, because she just went and did stuff. Mm-hmm. Right. It was so beautiful. And this is like the weirdest thing. One time, he's like, she's so good at this. There was one time I was like, I don't want to do this. I'm gonna dump this on Cheryl. I'm not doing this. Like, this is where I'm pulling the principal card. I'm dumping this thing on her. And I said, hey, Cheryl, can I talk to you for a second? And she's like, yeah, yeah. Hey, there's this, I know we got to do like this, these assessment things. Can I do that? I'm like, oh yeah, for sure. And that was the one time I was going to ask her. She actually, in the meeting I was going to ask her, she actually jumped on it and had no idea I was going to even ask her. She was just so incredible. She made my life so easy. She was just an incredible assistant principal and then went on to be an amazing, just incredible leader. Okay. Number two, I don't even know what I wrote here. Okay. So number two, I don't know. I know here's the title of what I wrote: determined to work towards success.
Well, yeah.
What does that mean? How do you do it in your job?
Determined to work. Well, I mean,
determined to work towards success.
Hopefully, and I think this is true with educators, is that you're trying to be the best version of yourself every single day. However, the job is hard, right? It doesn't matter where you are in the role of education, and sometimes that is lost. So knowing your why and knowing why you're doing the job that you're doing, to keep that passion, to keep that determination to move on, because I think that is lost, especially probably after the last 2 years that we've been in the job with the changes that have occurred in just the model of education. But yeah, you have to have that determination, because if you don't, then your motivation to be your best version or to find those solutions is going to be lost.
So this point, and I wrote really briefly, this point is out of my hatred for, we embrace failure. I hate it. I understand what is meant, but I think it just gives me something like, if you said like, oh, like we totally screwed up this year with your kid, but we embrace failure. I'm like, well, that doesn't really help my kid. Right. Yeah. And so it's kind of like saying, AJ Giuliani talks about this, the difference between failure and failing. And he says it way better than I ever will, but it's like the idea, you know, I'm sure, you know, like I've lost a lot of weight, you know, kind of went through this health process. And there's a lot of things that, you know, didn't work for me, but I learned from the process and kept moving forward until I started actually getting to the places that I wanted to be.
Yep.
I think when you think of failure, it's like, well, I guess that's it. We're done. Mm-hmm. Right. And I think that's where that point came from. All right. Sure. Okay. So I already know that you do these things really well. So like, I feel like I'm just giving you like softballs here.
You're just setting it and I'm spiking at this point. I love it.
Totally. Okay. So three, always takes ownership when things go wrong, but always gives credit when things go right.
Love that.
Okay. So like, tell me a little bit about that. What does that mean? What does that mean to you?
Well, I think it's similar. Well, you're modeling it right now, right? I mean, you're giving me a platform. You're lifting me up. I mean, that's what I think every leader should do. I mean, especially with aspiring leaders, I think you should give them the opportunity. And then when they do well,
don't be dumping. Don't be dumping.
you're praising everybody. I think you don't want to showboat, of course, right? You're not looking for the glory. I'm not looking for admin of the year or anything like that. If it happens, great, but that's not what my goal is, right? That's not the outcome. I'm trying to lift everybody up as a leader. I think that comes with the culture piece too. You know, if it's all about you as a leader and you want to just receive the praise and that's what it's all about. I mean, your staff is going to realize that, your students, you know, like everybody in your organization is going to understand that you're there for your own accolades versus the community. So I think that's, if you're looking to create a strong culture, then you are definitely praising everybody that you possibly can that's doing a good job, and not to be fake about it, but actually lift up when someone's doing the right thing.
Okay. So like right behind you, you got a Kevin Garnett, right? Is he your favorite player?
My favorite by far.
Okay. So Kevin Garnett, pretty determined guy, right? Okay. Love him. So I play basketball. I got my Raptor stuff in the back, all that stuff. Actually, have you been to, okay. So I'm not going to get into basketball stuff.
Do you remember this first? I'm going to interrupt you. Sure. Do you remember playing basketball in Plano, Texas? And I actually played against you.
Oh yeah. I was probably posting everybody up.
You were posting everybody up.
I was like 100 pounds heavier than what I was now. That's like the only thing I could do.
I was like, George Kiros is here and he can actually ball.
Yeah, I'm okay. I'm better now. You watch out. Next time I'm in Texas. Okay. So I'm going to give you a really good example of this in basketball. Okay. So always takes ownership when things go wrong, but always gives credit when things go right.
Yes.
So when I play basketball, I was a pretty good passer. Like I was a good pass, right? And sometimes you would just give the perfect pass to a player, right? To someone on your team, and they would screw it up and they would drop the ball. Or they'd miss like an open layup. And every time that happened, I would go, my bad, my bad. Cause I know that if I'm like, what are you doing? Like I just put it there perfectly. The next time that person actually is going to be even more hesitant, right? Sure. And the one analogy I've always really appreciated when I was listening to a basketball coach, it's like someone shoots a free throw and misses. And then the coach says, hey, don't miss the shot. And it's like, oh yeah, no, I was trying to miss.
Good
right?
advice.
Like, that's what I was trying to do. So it's like, you know, you give that advice, right? And then the next time when you put the ball right where it's at, and then you do the perfect pass to put them in this perfect situation and they score it, it's like, that's all you, right? And it's kind of like you want to build that confidence, and that's what you should be doing, you know, as a leader. Okay, so last one. They will challenge authority. So as an assistant principal, how do you do that? Do you see that as something that's important? How do you look at that?
Well, I think it kind of goes back to what we were talking about before about your identity, right? If you're doing things without questioning and you're just doing it, then I don't think that's best for everybody involved, including yourself, because I think then you're becoming and pretending to be someone that you're not. So I have challenged authority when it comes to certain decisions, because there are certain things that I will die on the hill for because I'm so passionate about it, because I don't think it's right. Now, that is being said, I had a very good working relationship with the principal involved. And it wasn't like, you know, from day one, I was coming in saying, no, I don't believe in this. I'm not going to do that. Obviously, you need to figure out, you know, why the fence is there before you break and knock it down. So, you know, obviously, you got to have those relationships. You got to do it in a way that you're communicating respectfully. You know, you're not demeaning. Right. You're having those crucial conversations where you're allowing them to understand where you're coming from and why you think, you know, it may not be the best decision. And then of course, not just complaining, you're bringing something to the table also. So we're being solution oriented. Mm-hmm. You know, that's a pet peeve of mine, of people bringing a lot of problems, but then right. never bringing any solutions to the right. table. So you don't want to be that in administration. So I think, yes, it's
you don't want to be like, that's dumb.
Right. And then walk away. I think it's healthy because, you know, if you have a good administrative team, then you do want to be challenged. If I'm doing something that's going to be a negative for my teachers or for my students, and nobody ever calls that out and just is a yes, ma'am, or yes, sir about it, then how am I better? How is my campus better? Like, we do right. need to have some opportunities to push back on certain things so that we can get the best result or the best practice.
All right. So this goes back to when I first got hired as assistant principal. I got an interview with my soon-to-be principal, and we actually fought in the interview. I'm not even kidding. We were like yelling at each other. It was bad. So I was like, that was literally the worst interview I've ever had. And then I actually got a call from him 2 days later, and I was like, going to be like, you didn't get the job, and sure. I never want to see you again. Right. And I was kind of liking it to, you know, like when we walked away, it was like, well, I had a nice time. And, you know, it was kind of one of those dates. Like, that's how I thought I was going to end up. Like, yeah, nice time, but I'll never see you again.
Sure.
So he said, I would like to offer you the job. I'm like, are you kidding? And he's like, yeah. He's like, you're the only one who challenged me. Hmm. And he said, basically, my job is to do what's best for kids. And I don't always get it right. And if I have someone who just agrees with everything I do, that's not going to be helpful. It's like, there is, like, let's not pretend there's no ego involved in this too, right?
There is.
So like, he wants to do well, right? But he knows this, and I know this. The only way he does well is if he actually does best by our students and, you know, our community. So he said, do not put me in a position where you think I'm doing something wrong and you actually, you know, let me go out and talk to that staff and say something and look stupid.
Yep.
But on the other hand, I think this is important. He said, at the end of the day, I am the principal. And if something goes wrong at the school, the superintendent's not calling you. They're calling me. So I have to be, at the end of the day, I have to be comfortable. I am accountable for the decision you made. So if you tell me and I say, hey, we're still going in this direction, I need you to back me up.
Yep.
Because you don't want to be in a role where it's like, I can play the assistant principal versus the principal, right? And you can kind of feel that too.
Sure.
And so like actually going back to Cheryl Johnson. Cheryl Johnson was a teacher on that staff as assistant principal. Literally the first day I got in a fight with her. We got in a big argument. And 2 years later, when I became principal, I said to her, I need you to actually apply for this assistant principal job where I'm going to be principal at, because I knew she would challenge me. And I knew that we didn't always agree on things, but I always knew her heart was in the right place. I knew she knew my heart was in the right place, but our viewpoints weren't always the same, but we'd always try to figure this out. And it was really good. And we had some really, you know, Archie and I had like, we're like a brother, you know, became brother. We'd like yell at each other and people were like, you okay? We're like, oh yeah. Like, we're good, right? But we had that because we had that trust
yes.
to that conversation. I'm not saying like, go yell at your principal. Don't do that. But like, we had that relationship. And at the end of the day, it was all about doing what's best for kids, not about what makes me feel best, you know, like just agree with me. And I think a lot of times people hire who they think is going to be like them and think yes. like them, as opposed to, I need people with the same values of what we're trying to achieve, but need different perspectives and different viewpoints.